And this is a really simple idea. And most of the data is sort of given away by the name. But it turns out that, and it's like, it looks almost so simple that it's unclear what it's useful for. But it turns out that it's connected to many things, particular to algorithms and complexity. But also to many geometric questions. And I think I have some more. Yes, and even things like machine learning. And quantum information. Okay, so it's quite surprising, sort of, how many things, in how many contexts this this simple idea comes up. And so maybe just a few more things here. So here it's related to what's sometimes called spectral methods. This is sort of some kind of algorithmic technique or linear programming and semi-definite programming. Here it's related to the Unique Games conjecture and to a certain extent also to the question whether P is different from NP. And here it's related to the question of the Euclidean distortion. Subspaces. Here, the connection is through a question called tensor decomposition. So that's something that comes up in and sort of comes up in certain ways in machine learning, and in the ways it comes up in machine learning, it's also related to sum of squares. And here, it's related to the question of how to estimate the entanglement of a quantum state across subsystems. Okay, so you don't need to know all of these things, just to give you some hints. Okay, so let's start. So for the first lecture, I want to look at this in a very specific and somewhat simple and combinatorial context. And the context that we focus on will be about functions on the Boolean hypercube. So functions that take as input an n-bit string, and say the coordinates are either +1 or -1 in this case, and output a real number. Okay, so these kind of functions, they have a surprising number of applications. Somehow it's what they can do is they can sort of aggregate n binary decisions into a single number. And so one example here. One example of such a function which we will revisit a couple of times is for graph G. You can look at the following function, g of x. And this is the function that counts the number of edges ij of the graph, such that xi is different from xj. Okay, so what does it mean? So if you have here your graph, the vertices of the graph, now you look at the vertices where xi is +1, and you look at the vertices where xi is minus 1, then what you count here is the capacity of the cut for this bipartition. Okay, so this is an example of a function that, you know, has this form and will appear many times. And one very useful fact about these kind of functions is they admit these. Admit representations as multilinear polynomials. So multilinear polynomial is a function of the form. So you sum up over all subsets of the coordinates, some coefficient C sub alpha, and then a multilinear monomial corresponding to the subset of the coordinates. In here, there's a very basic fact. Maybe let me first introduce some notation. So let's call this function here chi sub alpha. So these functions are called the Fourier characters. And so what so the reason why these functions are useful is because they give you a different basis for functions of this form. And let's just record that fact. So if you look at these kind of functions over all subsets, then this is a basis. Functions on the hypercube. And this is space is orthonormal with respect to a natural inner product for these functions. And I mean, I'm sure many of you are familiar with this. And so, you know, that means that because it's a base, it means that these kind of representations are unique. In particular, these coefficients are unique, and these coefficients are usually, often, you know, we will write them often as f hat sub alpha. So that will be the notation for the coefficients of the function in the Fourier basis. Okay, so this is called the Fourier basis. Okay. Now, okay, so this is the basic object. These are the basic objects that we want to look at here. You see that there are sort of two natural ways to specify a function. So here, like the natural way, if I write it like as first here is as a truth table with, you know, dimension 2 to the n, so I, you know, have a table entry for every point on the hypercube. You tell me what's the value. Here you have an alternative representation where you represent the function by the coefficients in this particular in this other basis. But in each case, you need these 2 to the n numbers, and it turns out that there is we sort of think of n as sort of our input size in the kind of complexity settings. And so it means 2 to the n is a huge number compared to the size of the input. And so that means that we'd like to, but it turns out that many functions that we will be interested in, they live in a particular low-dimensional subspace. Okay, and this low-dimensional subspace corresponds to functions that have a small Fourier degree. Okay, so let's define it. So the degree of a function is the degree of its multilinear representation, which means that it's because if you look at this multilinear representation, then the degree of that is one way to write it is that it's the maximum cardinality of alpha such that the Fourier coefficient is non-zero. And the number of coefficients, the number of Fourier coefficients of size at most d is roughly n choose d, which is polynomial as long as the degree is constant. Okay, so another fact is that the dimension of the subspace of degree d, and here, but okay, so let's see, of functions f with degree at most d is the number of coefficients size at most d in the sense, and the way we will think about this is that this is bounded by n to some constant times d. Yes, and so what you think about is that if you have a function that has a constant degree, then it lives in the functions of constant degree, they live in a polynomial in a subspace of polynomial dimension. In particular, if you look at this example here, then we can see that it's a function that has degree 2. So it's just to play around with these things a bit. So one way to express this function as a polynomial is I sum up over all the edges of the graph, and now I want to have a function here that is 1 if xi is different from xj and 0 otherwise. And the function that one way to write this function as a polynomial is look at xi minus xj squared. And this would be 4 if xi is different from xj. So if you divide by 4, then you get something that is 1 when they are different. And if they are the same, then it's 0. Okay, so this is indeed the same function as before. And now and here you already see that it's a polynomial of degree 2. And just to write it as a multilinear polynomial, it's the number of edges. So the constant term is the number of edges divided by 2. And then all other Fourier and then for every edge, we have a Fourier coefficient. The Fourier coefficient is minus 1/2, I think. For every edge of the graph. Okay. And now, okay, so this is very basic things about functions on the hypercube, and there are these special functions that have low degree. And we will really focus on these functions that have low degree. And the nice thing is that I can specify this function just by specifying the coefficients for all these low degree characters. So in particular here, the number of coefficients I need to specify are only at most n squared. Now, the kind of question I'm interested in is, suppose that I give you a function that has low degree and it's non-negative. And the question is, how can you certify this? OK, Okay, so one way to certify is that you evaluate the function at every point, okay, 2 to the n points. Nice thing about, one thing I forgot to say, is the nice thing about low degree functions is also that you can evaluate them. Okay, so if you have a point x and you want to know what's the value of the function at the point x, then you can compute this value in polynomial time, polynomial in n. So in general, like if a general function on the hypercube, you might need exponential time just to evaluate it. But the nice thing about low degree functions, at least at least you can evaluate them. So the question is how to certify them in a in an efficient way. So you can at least at every point you can evaluate them, but there are too many points for you to afford to evaluate the function at every point. Okay. And so what we'll discuss is how to evaluate these, what are situations where we can certify these things efficiently. And one remark up front is that even for low degree functions, you can't really hope that there are small, say polynomial size certificates for these kind of questions in general, because if I look at this function, and I and they ask whether for some constant c, the function c minus f sub g is non-negative, then this question is equivalent to asking whether the max cut in the graph G is at most C. Okay, so you see that, like if you evaluate f sub G at a point X, it gives you the capacity of the cut for the bipartition represented by X, and so it means that this function is non-negative if and only if every cut in the graph has capacity at most C. Okay, so it means that if you could efficiently certify non-negativity of low-degree functions, and this guy has still degree 2, so it means that if you could efficiently certify non-negativity of low-degree functions, that would also give you a way to efficiently certify any true upper bound on max cuts of a graph, and this is this kind of statement is an NP-hard statement, and under standard this is a co NP-hard statement. So it means that if NP is different from co NP, you can't hope to have efficient certificates for these things. Yes. And some more example or some more discussion. So if you have a low degree function f and this would be violated, then there's a very easy way to convince yourself of this. Convince someone of this. Because then you look at, you give someone this point where the function is takes a negative value, and then you can efficiently compute that that the function is indeed negative at this point. So it means that if this is false, that has an efficient certificate. Okay, so it means that we should be careful about. I mean, we can only hope that these kind of certificates exist if the corresponding statement is not doesn't correspond to an NP-hard question or co-NP-hard question. The kind of certificates that we will look at will have a very particular and simple form. So degree d sum of squares. Certificate for G, for the statement that some function f is non-negative. So So what this is, it's a representation of F as a sum of squares of functions g1 squared. As a sum of functions g1 squared up to gk squared, such that each function gi has degree at most d over 2. And we will define the sum of squares degree of a function to be the minimum degree, and such that this kind of certificate exists. Okay. And one simple observation is that, you know, the sum of squares degree of a function. I mean, it's just this. Okay, so I'm now justifying why did I write here d over 2. So the reason why we do that is in this way. The sum of squares degree is always at least as large as the regular degree of a function.
You want equality as polynomials?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, excellent question. Yes. So this is important, and so here I really want equality as functions over the hypercube. Not necessarily as polynomial, yes. Because,
otherwise, you would need to allow also to use xi squared equals 1, right?
Yes, exactly. And somehow, exactly. And
so what's the distinction between these two? So, I mean, we saw an example of this. We have an example.
Yeah, here, for example, in this identity, I use that xi squared is equal to 1. Yes.
And how you got the E of G over
here. Yes. And in some sense, But the difference between the question whether this is true as polynomials or this is true as functions over the hypercube, the only possible difference could be because of terms like xi squared. So if you remove those, then the things are the same. And that's sort of the why I talked before about the fact that these multilinear polynomials are they form a basis for functions on the hypercube. So it means that those are really the kind of polynomials that, in some sense, what, yeah. Like, if you sort of. Yes, because if you think of this here as a polynomial, because each of these guys have degree d over 2, that as a polynomial has degree at most d. And so it means that if you have a representation of f like that, It means for sure that.
Then shouldn't the inequality be in the other direction?
Ah, okay. So maybe that. No. I think this is the right inequality.
It's a very special
case. So. Yes. Yeah. You can think of it like that. Yes. But I mean, yes. So the fact that you have this kind of representation means that the degree. Okay, so for functions over the hypercube, it's true that if you sum up two functions with degree at most d, you get a function that has degree at most d. But there can be cancellations. Yes. And there will be, there are examples where this inequality is far from tight, where the sum of squares degree. There are examples of non-negative functions f, even of degree 2, where this here is roughly n, or some constant times n, and this is 2.
But again, coming back to the point of Noga made, this happens exactly because there are squares there which you replace by ones, and this is how you get cancellations, right?
Yes.
If this were formal polynomials, then the degree wouldn't go down because they are summing non-negative terms, right?
Yes. But then it would be, I mean, so the that's right. Yes. I mean, it's completely correct. Yes.
I'm not sure.
No, I mean,
these level ones. The leading square term, how could you put it?
Yes, yes.
You want to keep it as square.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. No, I mean, yeah. So, but you know, but we are interested whether these kind of representation exists for every non-negative polynomials, and then what kind of degree do we need? Okay, so let's. There are a couple of remarks that I wanted to make here. Okay, so maybe. So in what sense is this a good certificate? Let's think about this. So the claim is that, if I give you G1 to given let me not write it as a claim. So I want to discuss in which sense this is a good certificate. Okay, because it's as functions over. Over the hypercube, and why can you verify? So if I give you functions g1 up to gk, and they are low degree, and suppose k is small, why can you verify that this identity holds, efficiently? Why can you efficiently verify that this identity holds? So the way you verify that this identity holds is just that compute here the polynomial. You're given g1 as a polynomial, okay? So now you look at g1 square, and so that's another polynomial, and you sum up all these polynomials, and now you have a polynomial that is possibly not multilinear, but now you make this multilinear reduction, you transform it into a multilinear polynomial by removing these xi square terms, and then this identity holds if and only if all the coefficients are the same. Okay? So that was what we discussed right now. So one maybe cute remark is that. Claim. So if the SOS degree of F is at most D, then probably a bad place to write this. Then the number of functions that we need to take is. Then n to the order d functions are enough. So by that I mean that if there exists a degree d sum of squares certificate for f, then it's actually enough. Then there always exists one where the number of functions here is at most. N to the D, roughly.
K is at most.
Yes, yes. K is at most N to the D.
If it can be proved, it can be proved.
Yes, yes, yes. And so any suggestions?
This is linear programming.
Linear programming? Yes, yes, yes. Yeah. I mean, many things are linear programming. Yes. Yes. So this is okay. At least for me, the kind of keyword is. This Caratteri-Lorentz theorem, but yeah, that's also related to linear programming. And what Caratteri-Lorentz theorem says, at least in the way we want to use it here, is that if you have a cone that is generated by a certain number of rays, this is maybe a bad cone. Then every point inside the cone can be written as for sure it can be written as a non-negative combination of points on the array, but it can also be written as a small number of combinations, as a combination of only a small number of those guys related to the affine dimension of the cone. Okay, and so how does it apply here? Well, this statement says that f is contained in the cone of functions g squared, where the degree of g is at most d over 2. And the okay, so these are the rays that generate the cone. So this guy's radius, and the affine dimension of this cone is n to the order d, because you know it's contained in a subspace of functions of degree d. Okay, so this is the linear Hall will actually be equal to the functions of degree d, and so it means that so the linear Hall has dimension n to the order d, and that means that f is a combination of a small number of extreme rays. Ah, okay. So
I'm not sure if everyone knows these terms. Cone. Ah,
okay. Yes. So cone is the such as a set of non-negative combinations of these guys. Yeah, maybe the more familiar term, which is almost the same situation, is that it's this cone is like a convex hull of these guys, and maybe the situation with convex hull is the same. It's more familiar, but
just make a picture with your fingers, and everyone will understand what it is.
Yes, so like an ice cream cone. Yeah, but it's just to make just to give some more understanding, and so it means that it will actually never be a problem that we need many functions. Okay, the only question is what's the dimension of the subspace that these guys live in, and we will focus only on these subspaces where it come by restricting the degree.
Okay, what's the dimension of the linear?
Second.
Equals the dimension of the
ah, sorry. Yeah, it's at most. Yeah, doesn't. Right. Yeah. It could be that it's just equal to a square. That would only be better. Okay. Maybe another good exercise is a claim that if you have a function that is non-negative, then its sum of squares degree. It's never more than 2 times n. Okay. Notice that this is not so interesting because, it's not so interesting in terms of efficient certificates, because that is not a strong restriction on the degree. So the dimension, the corresponding dimension here is just the whole thing, but it's still a non-trivial statement, because it could be it could be that I have a function that's non-negative, but it's not I can't represent it for any of these guys, but over the hypercube, the situation is extremely simple, one way to prove this is that you look at the square root of f. Okay, so this is a well-defined function over the hypercube. It has because we assume that f is non-negative, and now we can but the square root of f you can still represent it as a multilinear polynomial, because every function on the hypercube has a representation like that. But the maximum degree of a multilinear polynomial is at most n. Okay. So here the situation is easy, just because the the degree of the function root of f is at most n.
But you could have done it with this representation also. If each gi is multilinear because there is no point to make the gi not multilinear. I mean, just look at any representation of f.
Ah, no, but I want to show that they exist in the representation.
Yeah, but I'm saying take any...
Just being non-negative, why does it imply...
You're right. If you had a representation, then clearly it's at most...
So I use positive Sternsatz.
I wanted to prove the positive Sternsatz, yes. Okay. Yeah, so here, that's a proof of the positive Sternsatz for if you are over the hypercube. I mean, it's not a difficult proof. Yes. That's good.
Let us spell it out. So what we saw mostly is that if f is non-negative, then it is a sum of squares. That's the positive term.
Yes. We saw it for in the situation where you talk about functions on the hypercube. Yes. Maybe let's talk a little bit about the positive chance. That's just because that's the history of this. That's sort of where this where some of these questions came from. The way this came up historically is that you have some polynomial over some real polynomial in n variables, and you ask is the polynomial non-negative over Rn, and the question is, can you represent it is there a sum of squares certificate for this? And this sort of goes back to at least Hilbert. It's one of Hilbert's 23 questions. And here, the important result is by Artin, so confirmed this conjecture. But here it's not a sum of squares of polynomials, but a sum of square. If you can represent non-negative polynomials as sum of squares of rational functions. And then there are sort of more variants and generalizations.
But you cannot do it as sum of squares of
polynomials. Right. But you can't. I think something related to the geometric arithmetic mean inequality. So you can...
in dimension one, you can, right?
Yes.
In dimension two, there is already a
counter. I think three, yeah. Three, yeah. I mean, three variables, yeah. So there's some variance and generalizations. In particular, what like this positive Stellensatz or the null Stellensatz over the reals. And this is sort of this is the basis of real algebraic geometry. But none of these but the difference to our discussion will be that none of these results give you estimates or give you good estimates on the size of the certificates. Okay, so they give you sort of nice certificates, but in situations where where sort of it might be a priori maybe undecidable to certify this non-negativity, but. But they don't give you effective estimates on the degree, for example, and that's really what we are after, because over the hypercube sort of everything is easy once you have time once you have exponential time. And so now I want to give a couple of examples where you can control the degree in a meaningful way. And the first example, I mean, so these are, you know, quite simple examples, but maybe just good to start with those. And the first example is about edge connectivity. So the situation is that we have a graph with n vertices, and then two special vertices called S and T. It has some connections to the rest of the graph. And we ask, how many edges do we have to remove from the graph in order to separate S from T, so that there's no path connecting S and T. Okay. And another way to say this is, I'm asking what's a cut of minimum capacity that, what's the cut of minimum capacity in these n vertices in the middle? Where I think of maybe the plus side, plus one side as including S, and the minus one side as including T. Okay. So first, how can we phrase this as a question about functions over the hypercube? The way you can do this is simple. So let's define a function f of x as interpret x as a cut in this way and count the number of edges that leave. And
just to mention, coordinates are vertices, right?
Yeah, coordinates are the middle vertices. Mm-hmm. So the n inner vertices excluding s and t. So we sum up over all edges of the form S connecting some vertex I, and let me use this kind of I'm not sure Iverson notation. So this notation means it indicates a function that is one if this is true and zero otherwise. So this here corresponds, says that it counts the number of edges going out of S that are cut by X. And then let's look at the inner vertices, how many edges are cut here. So I and J range over the inner vertices. The edges okay, so this here counts the number of edges that I separate in this cut corresponding to X. And now the way we set this up is that F is at least K, if and only if the edge connectivity. The connectivity between ST is at least K. Okay. And now the claim, what we'll show is that this is also equivalent to saying that the sum of squares degree of F minus K is at most 4. Okay, and so it means that, these kind of statements. Okay, so they're not NP hard, but they are algorithmically non-trivial to answer. And what we say here is that actually you can answer it in this sum of squares way.
maybe just to make sure. So this set, the way you wrote it, is the degree 2.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
Like this, you can write as a
yes. Actually, a very good question. So, you could ask, is this, you could hope that this here is degree, sum of squares degree 2, just because I have here a quadratic function. I think that you can have examples where the sum of squares degree is actually equal to 4. I don't exactly know. So this is a good question to think about, come up with examples where the sum of squares degree here is actually larger than 2.
You mean
graphs? Graphs, yeah. It's a very simple example. If a graph works, then it should be the path, basically. So maybe let's prove this. Of course, what we're going to have to use here is Menger's theorem, which characterizes graphs that have edge connectivity at least k. And what Menger's theorem says that if the edge connectivity is at least k, then there exists the connectivity is at least k, then there exists k edge disjoint paths p1 up to pk from S to P. Okay, and so we want to use those paths to construct a sum of squares certificate. Okay, and actually I think I forgot to mention before that a nice thing about sum of squares certificate is that not only can you if they exist, not only can you verify that they hold efficiently, but if they exist, you can actually also find them efficiently. Okay, and so it means that, this assertion means that you can. It gives you a polynomial time algorithm to decide whether this is true. And the nice thing about this is that this polynomial time algorithm, in some sense, it's not tailored to this particular question, right? So it just looks at this function and interprets it as a quadratic function over the hypercube. It doesn't know anything about paths or the graph, and it just tries to express this function as a sum of squares of degree 2 polynomials, and it can do it. Okay. So this is an algorithm that works in polynomial time, but actually doesn't know which problem on some level doesn't know which problem you're solving. Yes, if you wouldn't want to think about exactly how to implement things, then semi-different programming would be one way to do it. Yeah. So let's.
But doesn't the algorithm lead to evaluate
F on all? No. The assumption is that whenever we have low degree functions, you're given them in the Fourier basis. So given by a polynomial number of coefficients. Yes. Okay, so let's verify this. So the way we will write F. So this is, I don't have like a super streamlined proof for this. It's a little bit cumbersome, but not too bad. So we'll sort of take F and then write it in a different way, and then repeat this a couple of times until we get the decomposition that we wanted. Okay. And the first step is that we will write F. We will decompose F into k plus one functions. F prime. And basically, what these k plus one functions correspond to is extremely simple. We sort of think of the original graph G And you know, we write it as a, you know, as these k paths. You know, plus all the edges that are not in one of the k paths. Okay, so we can sort of think, if you think about, say, the adjacency matrix of these graphs, then we write it as a sum of k plus one adjacency matrices of other graphs. And the first k guys are just the adjacency matrices of the paths, the k paths. And the last guy is the adjacency matrices of the edges that don't participate in any of the graphs, any of the paths. And this is, and so that means that, you know, as graphs, in some sense, this sum holds. And therefore, also as functions, this sum holds. So this is good, and now we will we will do things sort of in two steps. So the first step, first part is that f prime here, you know, this function here, it's of this form, except that we sum up only over the edges in G prime. And what we claim is that this function is certainly non-negative, and this fact has and has a degree 2 sum of squares certificate. Okay, so that's one thing that we will use, and the other thing that we will use is that, you know, for every I, the function fi is at least 1 everywhere, and this has this fact has a degree 4 sum of squares certificate. Okay, and so it means that, you know, I can represent fi minus 1 as a degree 4 sum of squares, and for each I, and I can represent f prime as a degree 2 sum of squares, and so it means that if I add those things up, then I get a representation for f of degree 4. Okay, and so let's see. So the first thing, so f prime is a function of this form. So let's maybe see why this is fine. And you know, it's f. So f prime is already a sum of things over, and each term here is non-negative. So we sort of just have to make sure that each of these guys have sum of squares degree at most 2. And this is true because, maybe the number here, claim 1, claim 2. So for claim 1. So this is just holds because if you look at, you know, x this function that is 1 if and only if xi is different from xj for any I in j, this is equal to, you know, we already saw this before, it's equal to this, and so this is a square of a degree 1 function. Okay, and f prime is just a sum of guys of this form. So it means f prime is indeed a sum of squares of degree 1 functions. And now, proof of claim 2. So this is a bit technical. So maybe let me.
In claim 1, you had the other two terms also, but they are the same.
Second?
In claim 1, you had also two other terms, right?
Ah, so these guys, you mean?
Yeah.
Yes, they are the same. Yeah. Yes. So they are, in some sense, just substitute one or minus one for one of the guys. Yes. But here, you know, we're just trying to prove that this is non-negative. So this is sort of a weak thing that we're trying to prove. Here now we're trying to prove that this is at least 1. So this is a stronger statement that we want to prove. And maybe let me just write it here. So if you look at a path, suppose it starts at the vertex S, and goes to some vertex 1, 2, 3, and suppose up to n. You suppose we have a path like this, and then it goes to t. Suppose this is our path p. And now we want to show that the corresponding function is at least 1, and to give us a degree 4 sum of square certificate. And now notice that, okay, so let's write this function that corresponds to this path. So, you know, so we are thinking of assigning 1 to S, and then, you know, let me just write it. Sorry, S X N. Okay, so this sum here is the function that we that counts the number of edges that we cut here. So we want to say that if you subtract minus 1 from this, this has a degree 4 sum of square certificate, and the way. And basically, the way we can do this is we can set up a telescoping sum that exactly gives us this kind of thing. And the way the telescoping sum looks like is okay. Okay, so we will add up functions of this form. And notice that each of these functions involve only at most three variables. So they involve only two variables. So you know, here x1 and x2, here x2 and x3. And notice that there's some kind of that there will be some kind of cancellation. So this guy here cancels with this guy, and this guy. Will no, ask here is x3, yes.
Yeah,
and
the first guy.
Ah, yes. Good. Yeah, that will be exactly. So that's what we exactly. Thanks. So this guy will cancel with this guy, and then this guy will cancel with the guy we're going to write here, and the last term will be 1 from xn. Plus xn different from minus 1 minus, and now, you know, so since minus 1 is different from 1. Okay, so that's the last guy. And this guy will not cancel, but this is our minus 1 that we wanted here. So this is good. And now notice that each of these guys here is actually non-negative. Okay. So this is something, you know, this is just involving two variables in each of these terms. And, you know, it's basically always the same term. So you can check that this is non-negative. And so that means that we managed to write, you know, this function on n variables as a sum of functions and a sum of non-negative functions, each on two variables. Okay. But each of these functions itself is non-negative. And now that you know this, we can, and basically because it's a function on two variables, it's sort of like the case that n is equal to 2. And before we said that if you have a non-negative function on n variables, the sum of squares degree is at most 2n. And so here we have two variables, so it means the sum of squares degree is at most 2 times 2, it's at most 4. Yes. Yes. Yes, 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 exactly. So this is, and that's also in some sense the reason why, you know, you don't really need semi-different programming to solve this problem. And the reason is sort of because each guy here is really like, just depends on a small number of variables. And that's on some level, that means that, that also linear programming can do this. But if you sort of didn't want to worry about this, then, yes, I mean, so it turns out that you can develop a similar theory, where instead of where the kind of certificates that you're looking for is not as you don't try to write the function as a sum of squares of low degree functions, but you try to write it as a sum of non-negative juntas. So juntas being functions that depend only on a small number of variables, and that. That corresponds to on some level that captures linear programming, and because here we only use non-negative juntas as a way to represent the function, that works here. But yeah, the next example that I want to give is precisely a function, precisely an example where juntas are not enough. I mean, the efficient flow algorithms? No, I don't think so.
Use
Yeah, exactly. Yes, yes. But yeah, the bottom line here should be that Menger's theorem is just a statement about sum of squares certificates. Of course it's a joke. It's not related, not really related to the fast algorithms. That's right. But. Yeah, it's actually a good question. I mean, sort of these particular sum of squares certificates are not related the thing is that it's not clear if the only sum of squares certificates for these questions correspond to Menger's theorem. And actually, I think on some level that might be related to these electrical flows. That sort of some. Yes, some of these, it could be that some of the, some sum of squares certificates correspond actually to these electrical flows that are used for fast algorithms.
So there's, I don't know, I think it's a folk theorem that Menger is the same as Max Kaplan flow, the same as Hill flow, but are all these also, are they all?
They would also correspond to, yes, exactly. And I just made this as a simple example because. Exactly, it's also captured.
It preserves this complexity.
Yes, that's right. Okay. For this particular problem, it's not. I mean, it doesn't help you. But the nice thing about it is really that, you know, these sum of squares certificates, they were not tailored in any way to this particular question. But still, they allow you to answer it. Okay. Yes. Let's hide this. Calculation here. So the next example, which will exactly be not about juntas, is MaxCut. And so this. Corresponds to the function that we wrote before. I just repeated. We sum up. We count the number of edges that we cut. We look at this function. And now let A be the adjacency matrix of G. And suppose it has eigenvalues lambda 1 up to lambda n. You know, and suppose the graph doesn't have self-loops and things like that. So in particular, it means that, and it's not empty, so it means that this guy is negative, lambda n. And so then the claim is that, the claim is that this last eigenvalue gives you an upper bound on the value of the maximum cut, and this upper bound is also captured by sum of squares. Just as a, so what's the upper bound? Yes?
You say Laplace matrix here, Baker? I mean, you don't assume that the graph is regular.
Yes, I think it doesn't matter. I'm not taking the normalized adjacency matrix, just the 0-1 adjacency matrix. N is the number of vertices. M is the number of edges. Yes, and the claim is that C minus F sub G has degree as a degree 2 as a certificate. So the fact that this is at least this is non-negative, this is a degree 2 as a certificate. It means in particular that the maximum cut is bounded by C. So let's first relate this function that we are trying to that we started with. Let's relate it to the adjacency matrix. So you can see that this function is equal to if you look at the Fourier multilinear representation like we did before, it's equal to half times the number of edges minus. You sum up over the edges, half times xi times xj. Then you see that this here is nothing but the quadratic form of the adjacency matrix evaluated at x, and I think divided by, divided by 4. Doesn't much. And okay, so this is good. Now because these are the eigenvalues of A, we know that A, you know, the spectral decomposition of A looks like if you let Bi to be the eigenvector corresponding to eigenvector lambda I, then A looks like this. And these guys are orthonormal. So that means that if you look at the sum of so if you sort of look at x in the eigenbasis and compute the square of the true norm in that basis, then it's the same as in the in the regular basis. And in the regular basis, you see that the square of the two norm of x, because it's every coordinate is plus 1 or minus 1, is just n. Okay. So and these are sort of the things that sometimes that's everything that we need to know. So now, if you want to prove this. If you want to look at C minus F sub G, then you see that half times m goes away. And what we really want to prove is, what we really want to do is, we want to give a sum of square certificate for the non-negativity of this guy times n. Here the 4 also goes away. So we want to have a sum of square certificate for this. And now you see that this is equal to just lambda I minus lambda n okay, here I replaced n by this sum, and then we have lambda n times this sum, and then and the quadratic form of this guy is the lambda I is times these squares. And also we get this, and because lambda n was the smallest eigenvalue, all of these guys are non-negative. And so it means that that indeed this is a sum of squares. So this is a degree 2 sum of square certificates. For the non-negativity of this function, and the non-negativity of this function is just the same as the non-negativity of this function. Okay, and here it's important to note that these are not juntas, okay, because these are the eigenvectors of the graph, and typically they will not be sparse vectors. So it means these guys here, they will depend on all the vertices.
David, I think perhaps a large fraction of the audience doesn't know what you speak about. You speak about juntas.
Ah, juntas, okay. Really? Ah, I thought that's, thought you advertised that. So junta is a function. So this junta is a function that, so it's a k junta. So it's a function that depends on most k coordinate. On at most k coordinates. And the equivalent way of saying it is that the Fourier coefficients are zero except for coefficients that are except for coefficients that are contained in a set of size k. But it's not so important at this point. And okay, so but one thing that is important, which I will wanted to prove today, but I don't think I have time for it. So the question is this a good bound? Okay. So we saw that they exist, that sort of the eigenvalues of the graph give us some certificates on the, give us some upper bounds on the function on max cuts. And the question is if those are good bounds. And turns out that they are not so good bounds. So in particular, there can be graphs where the true max cut is roughly half times the number of edges, which is as small as it can be. But lambda n is something like, so there exists, yeah, okay. But lambda n is something like minus 2m over n. So that's minus the average degree of the graph. And if lambda m is n is this large, then it's sort of approximately this large. Then this bound here just says that the max cut is at most the number of edges in the graph, which is not computationally not an interesting bound. Okay, but it turns out that that there are other ways of getting sum of square certificates for max cut, and they give a good bound. And I just want to say what it means to give a good bound. So this is a result by Gilmans and Williamson. And what they show is that for every graph.
So here, this could be even much worse, right? I mean, lambda n could be even much more negative because it could come from some small connected component of the graph.
Ah, okay. So.
I mean, the graph can be.
Okay, so for regular graphs, it should never be worse than this. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yes. That's right. Yeah. Yes. Yes. That you have some huge, bipartite clique. Yes. That's right. Say again. Yeah. Huge small. That's a good point. Yeah. So I usually have regular graphs. Yeah. Regular graphs in mind for these things. But yeah, that's right. I didn't specify it exactly. But that you could fix by looking at sort of at the appropriate eigenvalues. If you want to get this bound will be better than even after fixing the eigenvalues. Okay. So what Gibbons Williamson show is that for every graph, if you look at the maximum cut of the graph. So the maximum number of edges that you can cut in the graph, minus 0.878 times this function f sub g. You know, this has the sum of squares degree this function has sum of squares degree at most. Okay, and this is a good. Okay, why is this a good good bound? Because if you would replace this here by 1, then this function would actually be 0 at one point, namely the cut that maximizes the number of edges. And now it says that if you just make this a little bit smaller, then you get actually then you can actually certify that it's non-negative. And so this gives me a way to estimate the maximum cut of a graph up to this constant, because I would, I don't know. I would search for all, for every value c. I would look if c minus 0.878 times this function, if this has a sum of squares certificate. So this is something I can do in polynomial time. And I do this for all possible, basically I can do this for all possible values of c. And then, the smallest c such that I get a sum of squares certificate, this will be a good estimate for the max cut in the graph. It is off by at most this factor. Okay, but again, sort of the nice thing about this is that it's sort of, it's the same algorithm. We didn't change the algorithm. We just, it's still the same algorithm. We just, look at this function and try to find a sum of squares certificate for the non-negativity of this function. Okay, this is the same function, the same algorithm that solves max to min cut also solves this approximate version of Gurmundsen-Williamson. Okay, of max cut. Sorry. Okay, now my computer ran out of battery. Okay, so that's bad.
So if you would replace it by half, half should be trivial, right? Instead of 0.878.
Yes.
Then it is much easier to see with it.
It has a source to be zero because it's always true.
That's not necessarily. half is definitely easy to see. I think that corresponds to, the maximum cut is at least the number of edges divided by 2. So if I have here half, if I have here half, it's by multiplying with 2, then you're asking basically if m minus f sub g, if this has a, if the non-negativity of this function has a sum of squares certificate. Yeah, because if you have here half and multiply by 2, then what you have here is a constant that will be larger than m. And that's really asking whether this here has a sum of squares certificate. And that's true. Yeah. Because say again? or
yeah. 2m
yes, yes.
Fg is just, that's what Benny says.
Yes.
2m minus fg is just some facts m minus fg.
Yes, yes, exactly. Yeah, yeah. That's the certificate. Yes, that's right. Yes.
Okay.
2m? 2m.
This expression should
be
multiplied by
2,
but you
only
multiplied, yeah.
Multiplied
by
2,
but then this
2
you didn't
no. That shouldn't be. I mean, but you don't. You
also
want.
No.
Not
a 4.
No, I'm not. I mean, okay, so this bond is not so, I mean, okay, it's non-trivial, but it's not, I mean, I think also M minus F of F sub G has always a simple sum of square certificate. Basically because you can, because each of these guys.
But you want to get the half, right?
The half thing is.
Twice max cut, and twice max cut is at least M.
So I think.
Yes.
It's fine even with that. Right? But I think Noga is asking about. So there's this simple algorithm, like a local search algorithm for max cut, that always finds a cut with m over at least m over two edges, and On some level, like this algorithm, it does something different than the way I'm describing these algorithms here. So these algorithms here, they are about proving upper bounds on the true maximum cut value, and these local search algorithms, they don't necessarily give you they sort of give you a lower bound on the maximum cut value because they find a solution. And there's sort of some connection between the two things, but it's not that direct. Yes. Okay.
Did you say you had to use the electricity or the power? You need a connector?
I think it's fine. I mean, yes, it went out, but. It ran out of battery, yes. I have a cable. Yeah, I think it's, yes. I think it should be fine. So
here the same thing would be, if you would use the Laplace matrix instead of the, then it would be that the max cut is at most the maximum eigenvalue.
Yes.
The Laplace matrix. But if it's not regular, the eigenvectors are different. So it's not the same thing.
It depends what you mean by the Laplace. So if you by the Laplacian matrix, if you just think of it as
that matrix that has degrees on the diagonal and minus one in every place ij which are connected. That's the usual Laplace.
Yes, yes.
Matrix is exactly sum of xij and xj square, the quadratic form. So it's exactly one.
So it has different eigenvectors. That's what you're saying. That's a bit surprising somehow. I mean, so it somehow means that it gives a different certificate, but with the same kind of guarantees. Yes, yes. Yeah, that's a bit surprising. Yeah, I don't know. Okay, so I think I will. So maybe just I can mention something that. That is, you know, might be a nice exercise. So if you have a polynomial P, and it's a univariate polynomial, suppose degree d, then you know, P is non-negative, and only if there exists. Degree d sum of square certificate. And now here, I mean, like in the Summon Square certificate, there was a question, you know, is it identity as a polynomial or is it identity as a function? So here it's, you know, identity as a polynomial. And this is a nice exercise. So there are two proofs that I know. One is using, you know, the fact that you can factor univariate polynomials. And the other proof is sort of by picture and induction. Both are sort of nice proofs. But it's actually, I think at a later point we'll see that this is actually useful even in the multivariate setting. A useful fact even in the multivariate setting. So one important thing that I want to talk about So I mentioned a couple of times that if these certificates exist, then you can actually find them. And the time is related to the degree of the certificate. So, state this theorem. So if let's say the SOS degree of let's say F is at most D, then we can and find SOS certificate degree D. So a certificate for F plus epsilon. So where epsilon is an arbitrarily can be made an arbitrarily small value in time. N to the order d, and this is using convex optimization ideas, in particular semi-infinite programming. But there's sort of the underlying reason why you can do this is the following characterization of Summon Square's polynomials. And notice that. I mean, here I'm talking now about polynomials, okay? And that's I'm being quite deliberate about the distinction between polynomials and functions here. So if you have P, a polynomial in variables x1 to xn, and then P is the sum of squares and only if there there exists a positive semi-infinite matrix. Such that P is equal to the sum of Aij Qi Qj and these okay, what are the Qi's Qj? So Q1 up to Q capital N. This is some basis, some fixed basis of degree D polynomials. Sorry, degree D over 2 polynomials. And here I forgot to say that this guy is degree P. Okay, in particular, you can take here the monomial basis. This is true.
Degree P or degree D?
Second degree of P is D. P has degree at most T, yes. And it's a polynomial in n variables with real coefficients. And then you can take any basis for those polynomials, for example, the monomial basis. And then the following statement is true. P is a sum of squares, if and only if there's a PSD matrix that you have this representation. And Yes, and
I'm trying to parse this. Mm-hmm. Qi you're now writing as a vector or?
No. Really, as here we multiply two polynomials of degree d over two, and here we have some constants. So this here is this here is formally, this is a I mean no, you can think of it as holding for every x, but we think of it as an identity for polynomials. And here we multiply two polynomials and we take a linear combination of them, and that's equal to this polynomial.
So Aij is a scalar, not a matrix.
Yes.
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 So one direction is obvious, right? Because you can change bases, and then you get this as a sum of squares. If it's a positive semigroup. Right?
Yes. I mean, but still, you're using the fact that the key thing to use here is that. A is positive semi-definite if and only if it has Cholesky factorization. Yes. And that's actually, I mean, also in both direction, that's
yes. Yes. Like A is M M transpose, and then this is M cube.
Yes. Yes. And yeah, in some sense, like this is you can really sort of reduce to. So this is the fact that Cholesky factorizations. Are equivalent to PSD matrices. It sort of says that this is the same if you have degree two, and in some sense, once it's true for degree two, it's also true for every degree. Yes. And this is really what this characterization underlies the fact that you can find these guys, you can find these certificates efficiently. Yeah, I think I'm out of time, and let me stop at this point.